ओके, सो कनिको, दिस इज कनिको. तो वी यूज कनिको टू बिल्ड डॉकर इमेजेस, राइट? यू नॉर्मली डू डॉकर बिल्ड हियर इन योर लोकल मशीन. व्हेन एवर यू डू डू समथिंग लाइक डॉकर बिल्ड हाइफ़न टी इमेज टैग डॉट, राइट? दैट विल डू द डॉकर बिल्ड फॉलोड बाय अ डॉकर पुश, राइट? बट फॉर दिस यू नीड अ डॉकर CLI and the runtime, the engine to be running, the daemon, Docker daemon to be running. Okay, but then in a for a Docker daemon to be running, you need to basically have Docker running in that system. Okay, but in a Kubernetes environment, why we use Kaniko is the pods itself. We are not going. The pods are supposed to be lightweight, so we are not going to run Docker in that. Okay, and then Docker in Docker is also a problem because you are running this base, like this is running on Kubernetes, already using Docker. Now inside of Docker, you want to run another instance of Docker, right? So which is a problem. Now the other option of doing this is instead of using Docker in Docker, you will from the pod, you will hook onto the nodes Docker that is running. Right, but when you hook onto the nodes Docker, then you will be circumventing the entire Kubernetes thing. So whenever you're scheduling memory limits and all of that, it won't be taken into consideration because you will be hooking directly onto the nodes Docker. Okay, so any questions so far?
No, Nitin.
Okay, so that is why we use Kaniko. Now what Kaniko does is Kaniko runs, does the Docker build, does the Docker push without needing a Docker daemon. Okay, so you don't need any Docker for that anymore. There will be small, they have written some kind of this code to do a Docker build without doing any, requiring any changes to the Docker files or anything. The behavior will be the same, but you don't need the Docker daemon to be running. Without that only, you can do it with this. That is the key differentiator for Kaniko. Now, because we want to run our builds on Kubernetes pods, we want to use Kaniko. Okay, so that is the reason. Now, what happens when you are using Kaniko? Now you can schedule, saying for a build, you can give 400 MB and one CPU, and it will take that much space, I mean, that much memory, that much CPU. And if you, put around five builds of the same, if you need to auto scale, that can also happen. But if you go for another approach that is Docker in Docker, then you won't be able to, Kubernetes will not know how much of memory and how much of CPU will be used. Because how that will be provisioned is, you will provision a pod, which is a Docker container, one Docker container. You will provision that, say, let's say 400 MB and 1 GB, 400 MB memory, one CPU. So that is a pod which starts up. That does not do anything. That all it does is, it connects to a Docker and starts a different build. Now for that Docker build, it takes a separate set of memory and CPU, which is not calculated by Kubernetes because Kubernetes is not aware of it. You're directly going to Docker by bypassing Kubernetes, right? So you won't be able to track or maintain that memory and CPU consumption, and the cleanup will not be able to be possible either, because when you do Docker build, those images that are built are stored on the node as well, right? Because you're directly touching the node and not going to Kubernetes, even the image cleanup is not really straightforward. So to bypass all of those Docker in Docker problems, we use Kaniko.
So Nitin, there will be one Docker daemon running on the cluster where we host Kubernetes, right?
Right, right.
So Kaniko connects to that, you're saying?
No,
it doesn't connect at all.
The idea is, we do not want to
connect to that daemon. Okay.
So this is just a small this thing. So you cannot run a Docker images using Kaniko. Kaniko is a small tool which is used to just build the image from a Docker file. Okay. Any of the detailed actual description of why, what, and what are the commands, you can get it here. Like, of course, this will have a much better, description of everything that you want.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can go here and you will get pretty much everything and more than what I'm telling you. So you have everything there. So based on this itself, we have also made use of connection up there. Now, apart from that, what are we doing here is we provision a Kaniko pod here, container here. Also, we will set its memory limits and resources points for one particular build. After that, the next part where you would use Kaniko okay, it is actually to run the executor, Kaniko executor itself. Now, what Kaniko executor does and what are these? These are just some build arguments. Same thing as you use in Docker, when you pass build arguments, it's the same build arg and hyphen f the file name. So the detailed as to what each one, you know, this arguments does, you can find them here. You can go through in detail, like what is a build arg, what is a cache repo, what is a file, anything, like entire detail is available here. Okay, so that is the usage of Kaniko itself. Now, apart from Kaniko executor, right, this is the normal thing of how you would push and pull. So basically, instead of Docker build and Docker push, you will use Kaniko. Okay, the tilde command, and this is what that does the building and the pushing. Okay, so this is the Kaniko usage of it. Now, apart from this, there's one more additional thing of Kaniko that we use. Is image caching of it. What we try to do is in normal Jenkins scenarios where you're running it on a build server, right? All these dependencies, maybe Maven dependencies or something, if you run it on the host machine, like your computer, like your laptop, right? If you run a Maven build, once you run it, then the dependencies are all cached. So the next time you do a build, the builds are much, much faster because of the cache. Now in this case, what happens because you are doing a stateless build, because of a stateless build itself. One second. Hello. Yeah. Okay, so there's another concept where we use caching, right? Because before Maven and Node builds were used to run on your own system, and the builds used to happen on that same system over and again with the stateful builds. So the subsequent builds after the first build were anyways naturally faster because the dependencies were already. But in this case, what happened? Because we're going for stateless builds. Now the advantages of stateless builds are you don't need to clean up the Docker cache or you don't need to clean up Maven cache. Too much storage has happened. Somebody has to keep monitoring what is accumulated and all that. Those things you don't have to do anymore. Once the pod is killed, the build pod, everything is then removed. There's nothing else left in that. Like everything is clean. You're back to the state before that build, right? There's no build can affect the environment basically. Which is a good thing, but at the same time, the build time also has to be fast enough. We cannot always say that, you know, we cannot go with the slower build. So for that, what we can do is we can take a combination of things. One is use a base builder image, which will cache the dependencies of commonly used modules. Like for Maven, we use a Maven builder, right? So Maven builder is a Docker app here somewhere. Okay. So what this will have is it will already have a cache of Maven dependencies as the base image. And now when you build the your whatever app, right, by running it in this container, what happens is because the Maven cache is available in this image, all the builds are much faster now. Instead of taking 10 minutes, it'll now happen in 60 seconds, for instance, right? So that is the advantage of using a builder image, which has the cache of Maven dependencies or Node dependencies. But the other problem is now whenever this you start try to start a build, right, Kaniko will try to download that base image also always because it does not have the base image because it's stateless, right? Now what Kaniko cache will do is it will cache those base images that you provide. You can provide it a list of base images, such as whatever we are using in the Maven builder. So it will pick those base images from its cache. So whatever the Maven dependencies or the node dependencies builder image, that can be about 600 MB. So for every build, it will now not need to download that 600 MB image because it's already cached in the Kaneko cache. Okay, so that is the advantage of doing a Kaneko cache. So that is part of the Kaneko warmer, cache warmer. Okay, you can see a chart also of that. So if you see here, we are telling that cache these images. Okay, so whenever you are adding more new builder images, you can add them here so that your build time and your data charges will be even more less because you are caching the base image. So the base image need not get re-downloaded. And now since the base image is now cached, you are essentially caching the Maven and the node dependencies without in a stateless form. Even though you are doing a stateless build, you can still have the goodness of caching those things.
So here,
Okay, so this is
can you go back to the script, Nitin?
which one? This one or
No.
the actual?
Yeah. So
Okay.
where is it taking the cache warmer thing? Can you go cache warmer here?
So cache directory slash cache right here.
Ah, okay. So it takes from there, okay.
Yeah,
And
and this is a multi-read single write volume, okay,
okay.
which is mounted. So any number of pods can do a multi-read on that. So everybody will read that, keep reading. Okay, does this cache layer exist? If it exists, load that cache layer instead of downloading, and it will proceed further.
And which is a stateful set? A cache warmer is a stateful set, is it?
So yeah, I mean, so whenever you, so cache warmer will be a deployment actually, okay, because you don't need. So what cache warmer is actually a cron job, okay, because cron job will only run once at a time. Okay, you can say that the multiple concurrent runs can be forbidden, and that is always usually forbidden when we're running the cron job. At a time, a single cron job can be running, and this is always going to be a single time attached. So there will be one volume, a cron job will start. The single volume will go attached there. It will download if it is not already there, and it will die, right? And at the same time, because it's multi-read volume, all the other cache warmers, whichever pod starts, they can automatically mount that drive and say that okay, disk it mount the disk. Okay, it starts reading that. If it exists in the cache, it'll use that. If not, it'll download it.
But it doesn't use a volume, it uses node nodes storage.
What?
Unlike our stateful sets like the Zookeeper or Kafka, we don't provision any external volume for it, right? It uses the node volume.
No, no problem for it. It can be a dynamic PVC. You don't need to actually maintain that.
Right.
So it will automatically provision a volume also. And the difference between a stateful set and this, right? The key difference is stateful sets are needed when you need to have multiple replicas of a single instance of or a single application. Okay, that is when you need a stateful set. Now here you don't need it. You will never want multiple replicas of a cache warmer. Right? It's always a cron job. It's always going to be running a single thing, and it is always a single volume. Now, what happens in things like Kafka, Zookeeper? You need to have parallelly running two, three replicas of the same app. Okay, and the storages have to be independent. Okay, that is then we go for stateful set here. So here we don't need the stateful set.
And that's a multi-read, multi-write. And here it is multi-read, single write.
Is single write. Here it is multi-read, single write.
And whenever there is a new version of a builder, we have to just change this. And whenever the cron job next cron time runs, so it will pick the latest one.
Right, so here you can just add whatever you want images, and then using the same that Jenkins deploy to CI, right? You can just type Kaniko cache warmer and it'll redeploy it, and from the next time onwards, it'll you know, cache the new builds. It's
so
not just builders, you can put whatever you want. Okay, you can put it's not just builders, you can cache any whatever images you want. Now imagine for some reason you have different images also you want to cache, which is more frequently. You can cache those also, there's no problem. But generally builders are heavy, so we cache those.
Okay. And for this cache warmer, do we have any, we directly deploy this Helm chart or again through our deployment config, we can deploy from there, is it? In our deployment config, do we have Kaniko cache warmer thing?
I don't know. I don't remember. But anyway, like you can just... there's no overrides, right? So it's not there. We will deploy Kaniko cache warmer just as it is.
Okay.
But if you have overrides, then maybe a certain CI, if you have multiple CI instances and you want to run it at different time or something like that, different namespace, then you will have overrides.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So that is the whole concept. Again, the entire thing is nothing is new or something, but you can find everything, the details of why you use a cache and basically whatever we spoke, right? That entire thing you can read about, what it is, how to do that, right? How to use the cache again. So entire detail, you can find it on the internet. There's much more, like much more detailed description with videos and all sort of things. Okay, nothing new per se. You can always find documentations and guides and issues. You can, all of them will be addressed here.